First things first, I'ma say all the words inside my head. I'm fired up and tired of the way that things have been. Oh, ooh, the way that things have been. Oh, ooh. Second thing, second, don't you tell me what you think that I can be.
Hey guys,
I'm the one at the sail. I'm the master of my sea. Oh, ooh, the master of my sea. Oh, I was broken from a young age, taking my soak into the masses, writing my poems for the few that look at me, took me, shook at me, killing me, singing from heartache, from the pain, taking my message from the veins, speaking my lesson from the brain, seeing the beauty through the
a new arena. Coach Gabriel, hey, you there? I can't see you.
All right, let me check my video. There we go.
What's up, man? How are you? I had to represent today, so.
I see, man. I see. I like that.
I had to
represent. I like that.
So, listen, I know you're busy. I appreciate you taking the time. Just wanted to just chat. I'm glad to have you on the show. I don't know who else is going to join us, but I appreciate you taking the time. So, tell me, what is life like on campus right now? Students starting to move back in or what?
Yeah, hey, let me crack my door so somebody don't walk in here.
All right.
All right. Yeah, the other guys, they were going to jump on here, but we got called in the last second meeting, so I don't know if they'll get out of it.
Okay, that's fine. So just tell people who you are. I know who you are, but just give them a little bit of background about who Eric Gabriel is.
Sure. Eric Gabriel I'm from Athens, Ohio, up there, and coached somewhat close to you at Fort Loramie High School for a couple years there between Dayton and Toledo, I guess. I was the head coach there for 2 years before coming to North Carolina to coach college and bounce around D2, D3, finally to High Point, where I've been here starting my eighth year, believe it or not, and was able to meet you through, I guess, Dr. Cobain a little bit, our president, and get to recruit your son a little bit.
Yeah.
And been able to stay in touch and happy about that. Now I'm here and trying to live this dream that we're not sure about what's going to happen.
Yeah, wow. So are students and players moving in, or what's going on with you guys down there now?
Yeah, we have all the students came back last week.
Okay.
Work here. We're not doing any online stuff. It's all in-person classes. Dr. Cobain's got this place locked down and you know, masked up and sanitized. It's at the highest level you could possibly do it. You know how he does things.
I can imagine. But listen, your campus is such a beautiful campus. That's not a bad place to be locked down at. So that's not so bad.
Right. So, yeah, the guys actually started. They've been here for about a week. Official classes started 2 days ago. And then we got some rules and protocols we got to follow before we can get full workouts going.
Okay.
But it's going to happen. We're going to start full workouts hopefully by August 31st.
All right, gotcha.
We're doing some individual stuff right now, but yeah, everything is planned to go right now. You know, the NCAA is obviously a day-to-day thing.
It is. So tell me about the new recruiting class. How's the recruiting class? And you guys have some talented players coming back as well. What does the class look like, and how will you guys adapt and blend them in with the new players?
Sure. So well, we got our best player back in John Michael Wright, who was arguably the best freshman in the league. If he didn't win freshman of the year, but stat-wise, you could argue he was the best. And, so we were able to get him back, and then we brought in a slew of new guys. We got five new freshmen and a graduate transfer to mesh with five freshmen that played a lot of minutes last year. So we're still young.
Yep, extremely. But we do have
the graduate transfer. We have Denny Slay as a senior who returns, who's a four-year player for us. And then a junior in Caden Sanchez, who's from Columbus, Ohio, played at DeSales there in Columbus, who's a redshirt junior with a ton of experience. So the freshmen have been, from what we've seen in July, and then obviously just getting to see them shoot around and stuff here. Because the weird part is we only really recruited one of them in person.
Right, yeah. With the virtual recruiting, that's been a real dynamic.
Yeah, so I take that back. We signed one early in the fall who we had recruited all during AAU. We signed mm-hmm. him early, so we got to see him a bunch. Then we saw another kid throughout the year, Alex Holt, who's a 6'8 kid for us. We saw him a lot through the year, but he didn't get a visit in the spring because everything was shut down. Right. And then we signed a kid named Jaden House out of Richmond that we completely recruited virtually, who, due to the COVID rules, was going to go in the class of 2021, but decided the COVID rules allowed him to go in 2020. We were able to get him to, he was like, well, I'm not going to go to high school another year. I'm ready to go. He's old enough. He's got all of his credits.
Right.
So we were able to get him. So you got Emil Flowers, you have Alex Holt, who's a big guy. Both those guys are local. Jaden House, who is from Richmond, mm-hmm. Virginia. The graduate transfer is Lydell Elmore, who was a Division II player at Livingstone College. Mm-hmm. And 6'9", long, athletic, ton of experience, was an all-league player there.
Nice.
Averaged like 16 and 8. Just, we needed some experience.
Yep, for sure.
And he gave us that after we had lost. You probably saw we had a graduate transfer from Drake.
Yep.
Antonio Pilipovic, and he lost a waiver that he applied for through the NCAA and didn't get it.
Yeah, that.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, it's amazing. Sometimes the NCAA gets in its own way. So it's unfortunate.
Yeah, so after we lost him, luckily he was fortunate enough to go play professionally overseas, so he's back. Okay. He got to play. And we were able to get Lydell to come in, which was good. And then we signed a young man named Bryson Childress, who's a local guy as well, from Albemarle, North Carolina. He's a small little ball of tenacity, man. He's a little 5'8 guy that can really, really shoot it. Played at Hargrave Prep School.
Okay.
Just tough as can be. And can really shoot it. So we're excited about him as well. And then the last one is Zach Austin, who is from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, another North Carolina kid. He's about 6'7", forward, played a prep school at Moravian Prep. So he's got that extra year of experience and just really athletic kid. He's in a cast right now. He broke his arm this summer, his wrist, but he'll be back, in plenty of time. No worries there. But so, yeah, with those guys on top of the freshmen we brought in last year, and Coach Smith had said when he got here, his third year was the year. That was the year he kind of gets things really rolling. If you look at his history at Texas Tech and Minnesota, those were the years. So that's hopefully the plan here. Year three is the year.
Well, yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing you guys. Now, how's construction on our new arena? All set to go and all that?
Well, it was supposed to open December 5th. We were going to open it up. Okay. And it got delayed some because of COVID. It looks like it'll be in the spring. So okay. I don't know what, depending on what basketball season looks like, how far it stretches out. Probably a slim chance we play in it this year, but we're holding out hope. But it looks done. If you drive by it, it looks like it's done, which it's incredible. Yeah. $120 million or something. I don't know.
I'm looking forward to getting down to see a game in that arena. The campus itself is beautiful, and the pictures that I saw, just absolutely phenomenal. So it's just like a high point from a educational standpoint, and just everything you guys offer student athletes, just outstanding. I think that you guys will have a lot of success. Man, I just, whew.
Yeah, it, you can't believe it till you see it.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to it. So during this COVID and during this shutdown, what have you learned about yourself as a coach?
I've learned that we probably wasted a lot more time before COVID than we realized. And that's just me being honest. As you learn the amount of time that you have to really get things done. And when you're locked into one place, as coaches, we're used to being on the road and traveling right. and bouncing around and doing this. When you get locked into home for 6-8 weeks, at the beginning of this thing, you were at home.
Yeah, you were.
But we needed to recruit. And we were getting so much done on the phones and, thank goodness for internet and video. And we were able to do that as we could get a lot done in that short 6-8 week period. We signed 5 guys in that amount of time. And it was strictly just phones and built from the relationships you've built over the years and that kind of thing. So, and then getting to watch more film of not only recruits, but just basketball in general and learning, that thing. So you, you don't get stuck in the office with a million people popping in right. and out. And right. Now you miss that. Like, obviously we couldn't wait to get back and have our guys be able to walk by the office and jump in or get on the court with them. You missed out on a lot too.
Right. Yeah.
So maybe wasting time is not the right way to say it, but you were able to get a lot of other things done that sometimes get pushed to the side. Mm-hmm. When you're in the daily movement of it. And then the other thing is, I think a lot of people, and I don't have any children, but I've talked to a lot of coaches and I've been married for 13 years, but you learn how important that time is with your family. Mm-hmm. If you have kids, a lot of coaches got to see their kids grow up instead of traveling. Usually from April through July, we're on the road almost nonstop. And we were home, you know, it's the longest I've ever gone without being in a Marriott. I don't, you know, so my wife and I got to spend some time together and be a little more healthy and work out. And nice. So that was enjoyable, and that's been really good. And I'm sure you got to enjoy some of that at home with your family too.
It's been good because I learned a lot about myself as a person, as a husband, as a father, you know, it kind of put everything on pause. Like you said, I mean, it forced you to slow down. It forced you to think about what's important. And it's like, man, you know what? All this time, you know, waking up, seeing the kids in the morning versus the hustle and bustle of getting out. I've actually enjoyed it. So it's been a good change for me. But yeah, it's changed my way of thinking quite a bit. So yeah.
It was difficult at first, I think too, cause we all know people that were affected so negatively mm-hmm. by this pandemic, losing jobs, you know, financially, yeah. whatever, you know, housing, whatever it might be, being sick, whatever yeah. it is, we all know those people. We were very fortunate my wife and I didn't lose our job. We were still getting paid. None of us have gotten sick. None of my family's been sick. So you do, you know, there's a little bit of that's heavy on you, you know, cause you almost feel guilty at times. But you got to get the good out of it. Like we're saying, you had to take the good out of it. That's all you can do is control that part.
Yeah. So projected finish this year, where do you guys, you know, in the conference, you guys got a pretty competitive conference. Where do you see you guys at in the conference this year?
I'm always going to say first. I'm always going to say first.
And I didn't mean that to be a loaded question. I think we're going to finish next to last. I mean, sorry about that. Yeah, that was not meant to. I just, you know, I when they come up with their projections and stuff like that, High Point will finish third or they'll finish fifth. So, yeah, I mean, I know you guys have a very talented staff, yourself, Gatling, Gigi, and Coach Smith. I mean, you guys got some of the best coaches in the country. So I'm going to be rooting for you guys, obviously, because I've got a close personal relationship with you and got a chance to be down there and be with you guys. So I will definitely be rooting for you guys. With you guys being in the South as you are, Coach Gabriel, with the Black Lives Matter and all that stuff moving and going on, tell me what is the message to your team? What is your message as a staff to the community?
Well, Coach Smith did a really good job of when that movement started. I mean, it's been going on for a long time, obviously, right. as we know, but when it got so amplified and heightened and we all started to actually take some actions and we're working on that like we should have been for a long time. We got the players immediately on a Zoom call, mm-hmm. Wanted to see how they were feeling, what they thought, what was going right. on at home with them. Us as assistants tried to call them individually, you know, because right. you're on a Zoom call with 20 people. Sometimes you don't say some things that you might would want to say one-on-one.
Exactly.
So Gigi and myself and Keith got guys on the phone individually just see how they were feeling. It was interesting. Those conversations were very personal and very emotional and made you closer with your players, which I think a lot of coaches across the country have done a good job from who I've talked to of just listen to your players, see what they're feeling, see what they're thinking, because hey, you and I, we're not the youth anymore, right? Yeah. Like we need to know what they're thinking.
Exactly.
We need to know where they want this thing to go. And then we need to help them get there. Exactly. We can give them the history. We can give them what we've seen. We can give them what, not myself, obviously, but what Coach Smith and Gigi and Coach Gatlin have experienced, what my teammates and my best friends growing up have experienced and told me about. I can right. relay that to them and then help our guys, obviously, try to take some actions. For me personally, my wife and I have made a complete commitment to educating ourselves more than anything, from documentaries to I became an avid reader of of all the books you can imagine. If you see all the lists out there, I'm checking them through, and I've gotten through four or five already. Because I didn't know the history of I didn't know African American history as well as I should have.
Right.
Even as a white basketball coach, basketball being we're a black sport. We coach more black kids than we do white kids. That's just how it is. And I needed to know more, and that's what I've been doing. And then I'm trying to find ways to turn that into action, whether it's helping our players be involved or help me get involved, or obviously the NABC is doing the big voting push. Yeah. You know, everybody's going to be out
there. I really love how they're doing that. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and Coach Smith's on some ad hoc committees, and our staff's joined some committees, and we've been doing it that way. But there wasn't a wrong way as long as you were doing something, I think. And most staffs, I got a group of guys together. I think we had 40 some coaches from all over the country, all divisions. And we just got on a call, myself and Dwayne Simpkins from George Mason. He kind of led the call with me, and we just talked with coaches about what to do, what to think. And we approached it as what to do as a white coach and what to do as a black coach, because we were all white or black coaches on there. We didn't have any other ethnicities at that time. And that was interesting. And Dwayne is a phenomenal resource he's the associate head coach now at George Mason, but he gave us a million good things to think about that were really beneficial for me when I was calling my players to talk to them and get their feelings and thoughts. And he also made me feel better about the fact that, because as a white coach, I was hard on myself about, I haven't been doing enough. And I needed to do more. I needed to get more connected with some of the black players that I've coached. I've been doing it for 16 years now. So there's been a lot of guys come through. And what he did, he made me feel better about the fact that I have been doing things I may not have realized, you know, and then telling me how to have conversations with my family, the people that need to hear them. I need to pull those people along with me. That's probably what I haven't done enough. And he was good at telling me about that.
Okay, good. Well, that's good stuff. So as obviously 2021 recruiting class is coming through, you guys are looking at 2022. As you look ahead to your 2022 recruiting class, what are some of the things that you guys are looking for in a class to kind of take High Point to that next level?
Sure. We've kind of set it up to where right now we only have two seniors this year. We've got a commitment for 2021, which I'm not allowed to talk about, but we have a verbal commitment. So that leaves us with one open scholarship right now. And we're just kind of sitting back and seeing what the best available person is for that spot. It's actually a good spot to be with the way COVID is and not being able to recruit. If we had five or six scholarships open, whew, that'd be hard to navigate right now. But with one open, we're being a little more selective.
You guys can afford to be. I mean, I think that High Point will be in that talk with the mid-majors of the schools that are up and coming that are on that next tier. I think you guys are going to be that good. I really do.
Yeah, and we like where we're headed. We like the guys we signed. We kind of got all the guys we wanted. Even when we lost the grad transfer that didn't get his waiver, we replaced him with someone that we really wanted. It's not like we took any of our B recruits or C, you know, whatever you want to call it. We were able to get the guys that were kind of at the top of our list from the beginning. So part of it for us is going to be seeing where guys shake out this year. You know, you think you know a player you think he's going to be a wing, but we may end up moving him to the point or move him to a forward or whatever it is. Then once you see what your need is for that last scholarship spot, and then obviously there's the transfer world that you never know what could happen or injuries or you just hope. But I think our core group of guys, I mean, I don't see anybody going anywhere, but you never say never. So you have to.
Yeah. Yeah. I think there's too many kids that are allowed to go in the transfer portal. I just think I've gotten way out of hand in the last few years. I really do. I think it's a good rule. If the kid has to transfer, if the coach leaves, that's one thing, but kids are just transferring all over the place. And I think it's not good for college basketball.
Yeah. It's getting it's almost free agency. You know,
it basically is.
Yeah. And I do agree with you. There's circumstances, you know, a lot of kids go to play for a coach more than just whatever that school is. So that there are circumstances that need to be considered. And obviously the big talk is the one-time transfer rule now, if they'll pass that in the next year, where every kid can transfer one time, no questions asked, play right away. That could change things, but it could also limit things, because then you take away the grad transfer rule, you take away kids transferring a second time for whatever reason. So it could limit it. It may be better, may not. I don't know what the right answer is. That's why I'm down here, and we let all the smart people make those decisions.
I was on a podcast with Matt Painter and Dennis Gates last week, and the talk was about culture. And I brought up if the one and done rule is good for building basketball culture. I'm a firm believer. I think kids should stay in school at least 2 years, learn about money management and how to speak and stuff like that. Obviously, at the highest point, you guys are building the culture. What is your thought and what is your concern, if there's any, about the one and done rule, or should kids stay longer?
Yeah, that one's a hard one, because I do believe kids should be allowed to go out of high school. I do believe that. Absolutely. That's their choice. No other profession do we keep kids from if they want to do it. If you're good enough to go be whatever you want to be out of high school, you can do it outside of getting a teaching certification, or you got to pass the bar to be a lawyer. You know, those kind of things you have to have a degree and pass a test for. But if I want to go open a business out of high school and I got the means to do so, I'm allowed to do that. If I want to go be anything, for the most part, I can do that out of high school. So I believe kids should be able to do that. Now, we grew up Kobe, LeBron, yeah. Kevin Garnett. I mean, we saw it. Yeah. Now, there was failures in there too. There was plenty that did it, but there was plenty of failures too. But that's their choice, I think. If they do go to school, I would lean toward a 2 to 3 year commitment. I do like the idea of G League expanding into more, where if a kid out of high school wants to go play in that kind of developmental league, they can do that, which is what they're starting to get there. Like kind of the baseball model. It won't be perfect, but I do like, you know, I'm a traditionalist in the fact that I want a kid to come to a school and play at that school for 2 or 3 years and really build a fan base and build that culture that you're talking about, and you get to see kids kind of grow up and go on. I like that. But if a kid comes to, if I'm coaching at Kentucky and he comes here for 1 year and he can go make millions of dollars, I don't want to be the person to tell him he's not allowed.
My thing is that I just you want to be able to see those kids at the college level, because I think the college level is the best. Is it just best, the best basketball? I think the NBA is so vastly different. College basketball, you know, you got some great rivalries, and people watch it every week. NBA, people watch it, you know, during the playoffs or something like that. There's something special about college basketball. And it's nice to have the top tier kids. They can stay 1 or 2 years and you build those, you know, build those great teams. And like the fan bases are just great fan bases. You know, I think you kind of cheat the fan bases when they can only stay a half a year, or a year, whatever the case may be. That's my personal thought. So
yeah, and I think when people bring that up to me, and it's, which is really valid, as I would say to them, watch more mid-major basketball. Mm-hmm. Quit watching only Duke, Kentucky, North Carolina. Quit watching just those teams. I mean, we love to watch them too, but they're the NBA B teams. Like, yeah. come watch High Point. Come watch George Mason, come watch Davidson, watch these guys. And if you watch them for 3 or 4 years, you'll get that. You'll see a kid as a freshman playing 4 or 5 minutes a game. And then by the time he's a senior, he's an all-league player. We get those guys.
Yeah. I would agree. You really do. So, all right. As I close out, again, I appreciate you being on. This has been great. Yeah. High Point has such a different knack. Just one, the most beautiful campus I've ever seen. What do you tell kids? What's the best thing about High Point? You've been there a lot. So, I mean, you've been there 8 years, and, you know, you and I connected under Coach Cherry, and now we connected, stay connected under Coach Smith. I know what I feel about High Point, but you're right in it. What's the best thing about High Point?
Yeah, I've had a unique perspective. I've been here 8 years, but I've had 4 jobs. I came in as a video guy under Coach Cherry, Then I became the director of player development under Coach Cherry. I became an assistant for Coach Cherry, and now I'm an assistant for Coach Smith. So I've gotten to see it kind of in different levels, although all basketball coaching, but I would, it's hard for me to ever say anything other than the people of the university. You know, you see the buildings and the beauty and there's the culture that you talk, everything is amazing. But when you walk on High Points campus, from the time you meet a security guard to the time you meet a person mowing the grass, the custodian, a professor, the president of the university walking around, the vice president's walking, every single person will probably stop you and say, can I help you today? You having a good day?
Yep. I can attest to that. Yep.
It is the people. And I mean, that's credit to Dr. Cobain. He's built the culture he has built. And for anyone that's never heard him speak or read about him, or he's amazing.
He is next level. He really is. Yeah. It's, I would agree with the people.
So. Yeah. That's a pretty easy one. And even when, you know, you think High Point might, if they hire someone that's doesn't fit, they want, one of two things happens. One, they leave fairly quickly. They're just, this isn't for them. Or two, they change. Like they may come in and one of those people that hates going to work every day or just doesn't want to fit the culture of High Point. Then they see everyone else. I mean, you go through the culture training when you get here. That's the first thing you do when you get hired at High Point. All 1,600 employees now or something like that. You go through a culture training and it's like, after that, you got it. And everybody's on the same page and you can ask our players. I mean, they'll tell you, from the lady that checks them in at the cafeteria to their professor that has 6 doctorate degrees and written 5 books, like they're all on the same level for the culture. And I mean, you saw that in the time you've been here. It's really amazing.
Yeah, it really is nothing like it. All right. So tell Tubby, I need him to answer a question for me. What's it like to coach at his alma mater? I know it's got to be pretty special, but I would love for him to answer that question for me, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I wish he knew if he was out of his meeting. Let me peek in the door. All right. And let him answer.
Yeah, I want to ask him that question because I know it's been pretty special to him. And, when I walked in, I saw his, you know, picture on the wall and all that. And that's got to be something. That's got to be really something.
Yeah. I mean, it's been obvious. I'm really fortunate to be a part of it and was very fortunate that he asked me to stay on when he did and then get to work with his son, Gigi.
Yeah.
The first time Gigi's worked for him since he was the GA at Kentucky.
Yeah, okay.
So Gigi, he did his own path, you know, becoming the head till he became the head coach at Loyola and then ended up here when Coach got the job. So it's been interesting that, you know, you get to work with the father and son that's both been head coaches, and Gigi, you know, was really good at Georgia. He was an all SEC player at Georgia. I got all SEC point guard on my right in this office. And I got Keith Gatlin as all ACC point guard on this side.
Really?
And then there's me.
And somebody's got to keep those guys intact. So there you go.
You know, I say we ever have I was the Division II point guard from West Liberty. So we've got some point guards.
Yeah.
We've got a couple point guards. I'm playing on the wing. I don't even need to dribble. You can just throw it to me.
Hey, I appreciate you coming on. Tell Coach Smith and Coach Smith, I said hello. All the best to you guys. And let's please stay in touch, my friend.
Yeah, thanks, Terry. I was glad we finally got to do this. Sorry I couldn't. I thought we had everybody, but it's a little bit wild around here.
I get to talk to you, so that's not so bad. So I'm okay with it.
Good. Well, how did Cameron get moved in? Is he good?
Tomorrow. Yep, tomorrow. It's going to be a watershed moment. So, yeah, he's all excited to get down there. I talked to the coaching staff today. So, yeah, he's ready to go, man. I'm very proud of him, and just I can't – I'm looking forward to it. So it'll be different just, you know, seeing him off the college and doing his own thing. But I'm extremely proud of him. So,
yeah, well – I'm glad for him, and I'll be following him and excited to where it goes. But I'm glad he's getting to play ball at the next level, man. That's the main thing.
Well, thank you for everything. Reach out to him if you want. I'm sure he'll be glad to hear from you. So
good. Thanks, Terry.
Take care. Be safe.
Yep, you too.
All right, bye. Great stuff there. So we didn't get to get Coach Smith on, but Coach Gabriel was just awesome guy. We're
up and down the court, just like I was a king on the microphone. So was Dr. J and Moses Malone. I like slam dunks, taking it to the hoop. My favorite place still is the alley. You I like to pick and roll, I like to give and go. Cause it's basketball, I'm Mr. Kirchner.
This day is basketball.
Go to dinner, then take my girl, see Tiny, play against Earl the Pearl, and we'll
that's all, folks.